a two-step integrated theory of everything, revision A. If you go to my homepage, you will find the article upon which the presentation is based and a copy of the view charts of this presentation. There are two opposing theory of everything visions. My vision is the two-step approach consisting of a fundamental physics step followed by a math step. The prevailing vision is Stephen Hawking's single mathematics step. Two steps are essential because of unknown answers to physics questions such as what are Higgs forces, dark matter, dark energy, and stellar black holes, and what caused the start of our universe, baryogenesis, and the cosmological constant problem. Hawking's single math step is dependent upon answers to these questions, but cannot answer the questions by itself. Furthermore, after nearly a century of attempts, the single math step has produced near zero results. There are three goals of my fundamental physics step. The first goal defines everything as 20 interrelated amplified theories and their intimate physical relationships with each other. These theories include string theory, particle creation, inflation, Higgs forces, spontaneous symmetry breaking, dark matter, dark energy, the super universe, stellar black holes, black hole entropy, the black hole information paradox, baryogenesis, and quantum gravity. The definition required 10 years and a brute force approach using 250 iterations of my theory of everything article. The presentation describes the replacement of five independent existing theories, which had no relationships with each other, by 20 interrelated amplified theories that have an intimate physical relationship with each other. And everything will be summarized in table 5, which is the last, one of the last charts in the presentation. The second goal of my fundamental physics step answered all of the key outstanding physics questions. What are Higgs forces, dark matter, dark energy, and stellar black holes? And what caused the start of our universe, baryogenesis, and the cosmological constant problem? The third goal of my fundamental physics step provided correct inputs. For example, there are 129 fundamental matter and force particles in our universe, and that is for the two-part math step. The first part is an amplified E8-Lie algebra technique, and the second is an amplified n-body simulation technique. Our universe's 128 fundamental matter and force particles were created from the superforce. They were created from the beginning of inflation at 5 × 10⁻³⁶ seconds to t equal 100 seconds. And they were formed under extremely high temperatures in our early universe, between 10⁷ and 10⁰ degrees Kelvin. By 100 seconds after the Big Bang and at a temperature of 10⁰ degrees Kelvin, only 22 permanent matter force particles remain of the original 129. Atomic, subatomic matter particles consisting of the up quark, the down quark, the electron, electron neutrino, muon neutrino, tau neutrino, they constituted 5% of our universe's energy mass. Dark matter consisted of the zeno, the photino, and three permanent Higgsinos associated with the graviton, the gluon, and photon, and they constituted 26% of our universe's energy mass. And dark energy was the sum of 8 Higgs force energies associated with 8 permanent matter particles, the up quark, the down quark, the electron, electron neutrino, muon neutrino, tau neutrino, the zeno, and photino, and they constituted 69% of our universe's energy mass. Furthermore, these percentages remained constant for 13.8 billion years, which meant there was no quintessence in our universe. Universes were created by four sequential star gravitational collapse stages. In a white dwarf star, molecules decompose to atoms. In a neutron star, atoms decompose to protons and neutrons. In a supermassive quark star matter, the protons and neutrons decompose to up and down quarks. And in a supermassive black hole energy, the up and down quarks decompose or evaporated to superforce particles. Matter decomposition was intimately related and the reverse of our universe's matter creation. A single string theory unites all known physical phenomena from the near infinitely small at the Planck cube scale to the near infinitely large at the superuniverse or multiverse scale. There were three string theory amplifications. First, there were 129 fundamental matter and force particle types in our universe, each consisting of a closed string within a Planck cube. There were 16 standard model particles, there are 16 superpartners, there are 32 antiparticles, and there are 64 supersymmetric Higgs particles. The 129th particle was the superforce or mother particle. Each of these 129 matter and force particles could be equivalently represented by a point particle that was a zero brain, a closed string, which was a one brain, or the Calabi-Yau membrane, which was a two brain. The six extra dimensions are the point particle's velocity and position inside the Planck cube. The second string theory amplification was any object in the superuniverse could be defined by a volume of contiguous Planck cubes containing these 129 fundamental matter and force particle types. So a proton, an atom, a molecule, an encyclopedia, a person, a quark star, or the entire superuniverse could be defined by a volume of contiguous Planck cubes containing these fundamental 129 matter and force particles. The third string theory amplification was superforce string. Donuts, physical singularities existed at the center of Planck cubes at the start of the superuniverse, or precursor universes and all universes, including our universe. Our universe's donut physical singularity contained 10 to the 54th kilograms of energy, and that physical singularity was created in our precursor universe by the evaporation, deflation, and collapse of a maximum entropy super-supermassive quark star matter to a minimum entropy super-supermassive black hole energy, and that's what caused our universe and the start of our Big Bang. Pauli's exclusion principle exists for an electron in an atom as four quantum numbers which define the shape of the orbit, the size of the orbit, the inclination of the orbit, and the spin of the electron. Pauli's exclusion principle was amplified for free electrons, up quarks and down quarks, which existed in the hot quark gluon plasma at the beginning of our universe. No two matter particles can occupy the same Planck cube, whereas force particles can occupy the same Planck cube. And the best example of that is that donut-shaped singularity, which consisted of superforce particles of every matter and force particle in our universe. They were superimposed one on top of another in a donut-shaped singularity at the center of a single Planck cube. This shows the proposed standard model supersymmetric matter and force particles. On the left are the standard model particles, on the right are the supersymmetric. There are four standard model force particles, the graviton, the gluon, the WZs, and the photon. And there are 12 matter particles consisting of six quarks and six leptons. Over on the supersymmetric side, there are four supersymmetric matter particles, the gravitino, the gluino, the winozinos, and photinos, and there are 12 force particles, which are the superpartners of the six quarks and six leptons on the standard model. Now, the standard model and the supersymmetric model do not contain the graviton or the gravitino. I basically amplified those models to incorporate it with the rest of the theory. A particular matter or force particle is uniquely defined by a subscript. So, for example, the 11 and P11 defines the up quark matter particle. Similarly, the 16 and P16 defines the photon force particle. If you add 16 to the basic subscript, that gives you the supersymmetric particle. So if P11 is the up quark matter particle, adding 16 gives you P27, and that's the subquark force particle. Similarly, if P16 is the photon force particle, adding 16 to that gives you P32, which is the photino matter particle. If you add the word bar to the subscript, that gives you the antiparticle. So if P11 is the up quark matter particle, adding the word BAR, P11BAR gives you the up quark antiparticle, which is a matter particle. And most importantly, if you replace the P with an H, you define the Higgs particle associated with the matter or force particle. So if P11 is the up quark matter particle, H11 is the Higgs force associated with the matter particle. If P16 is the photon force particle, H16 is the Higgsino associated with the photon force particle. Two reasons for replacing the inadequate existing matter and force particle symbols were explicit Higgs particle representation and elimination of existing symbol ambiguities via standardization of subscripts and capitals. Explicit Higgs particle symbols are required. I said there was a Higgs particle for each of 64 matter and force particles. A matter particle has an associated Higgs force, a force particle has an associated Higgsino. The sum of 8 Higgs force energies associated with 8 permanent matter particles is dark energy. Dark matter is the zeno, the photino, and 3 permanent Higgsinos associated with the graviton, the gluon, and the photon. And that is dark matter. Following are 6 examples of existing symbol ambiguities which can be eliminated via standardization of subscripts and capitals. There are 8 types of gluons, which I designate P subscript 2, and they are explicitly represented by P2A all the way to P2H. In the existing literature, I never saw an explicit symbol for each of those 8 gluons. The photon P16 is categorized in 2 types, P16A for electromagnetic radiation and P16B for force carrier photons. The electromagnetic radiation is further subdivided into gamma rays, P16A1, X-rays, P16A2, all the way down through the electromagnetic spectrum. The existing photon symbol gamma illustrates the ambiguities because all of electromagnetic radiation and just the gamma ray radiation is designated by gamma. Furthermore, there is no force carrier photon defined, and there are differences between electromagnetic photons and force carrying photons. The third example are the WZs, which are designated as P subscript 15. These are hybrid matter force particles. The WZs are transient matter particles with force particle spins of 1, and they're associated with Higgs forces. The next example is there are 64 superforce types, not one, and that will be described when I talk about spontaneous symmetry breaking. total particle energy mass is represented by an uppercase letter. For example, capital P subscript 11 is the total energy mass of all the up quarks in the universe. And that is important when I talk about the Big Bang timeline, and that will be a subsequent chart. And lastly, there are 64 superforce energy densities, not one, and that will become evident when I talk about spontaneous symmetry breaking. The Big Bang timeline x-axis has two scales, time in seconds and temperature in kelvins. The reason for this is there's an intimate relationship between the matter creation time and its energy mass. Matter creation was amplified to be time synchronous with both the inflation start time and the 1 to 7 Planck cube energy to energy matter transformation. Only uppercase letters are used in the Big Bang timeline. And total energy mass, for example, capital P subscript 11, consisted of three types of energy. Rest mass energy, kinetic, which is translational plus rotational, and potential, which is gravitational, electromagnetic, and nuclear binding. This is the Big Bang timeline, and you will notice there are two scales on the x-axis, time and seconds after the Big Bang, and temperature in kelvins. The reason for that is there's an intimate relationship between the creation time of a particle and its energy mass. So for example, the WZs were created at time 10 to the exponent minus 12 seconds at a temperature of 10 to the 15 degrees Kelvin. And according to this formula, that is approximately 100 giga electron volts. The second item you should notice is that all of these symbols are capital letters. In other words, I'm interested in the total energy mass of all the up quarks in the universe, all the down quarks in the universe, and all the superforce particles in the universe. At time t equals zero, our universe consisted of a donut-shaped singularity of superimposed superforce particles stacked one on top of another, and capital PSF equals 10 to the exponent 54 kilograms of energy. By the start of matter creation, that donut-shaped singularity had been transformed to a spherical singularity inside a Planck cube. This was performed by conifold transitions, and from this time on, the shape of our universe was a sphere which kept expanding. I made the start of matter creation time synchronous with the inflationary period and the 1 to 7 Planck cube energy to energy matter transformation. So at the start of matter creation, we had a single Planck cube, and in that Planck cube was the singularity, spherical singularity, which contained all the energy mass of our universe. There are six faces to that Planck cube. If you add a face, you add a Planck cube to each of those faces, you get the 1 to 7 Planck cube energy to energy matter transformation. At the start of matter creation, some of the energy in that singularity in that center Planck cube condensed out either to a single superforce closed string in a Planck cube or a single matter particle closed string in a Planck cube. Once that first shell was completed, it was pushed out, and a second shell of either superforce single strings in a Planck cube or matter particle strings in a Planck cube condensed out. This cycle continued for less than a billionth of a billionth of a billionth of a second, such that our universe went from a singularity smaller than a Planck cube at the beginning of inflation to an 8-meter sphere at the end of inflation. At that time, we had a hot quark gluon plasma with a temperature of 10 to the exponent, 25 degrees Kelvin. By the end of matter creation, at time t equal 100 seconds, the 129 matter particles had been reduced to 22 permanent matter and force particles. Atomic, subatomic matter consisted of the up quark, the down quark, the electron, electron neutrino, muon neutrino, tau neutrino, and they represented 5% of our universe's energy mass. Dark matter consisted of the xeno, the photino, and three Higgsino types associated with the graviton, the gluon, and photon, and they represented 26% of our universe's energy mass. And dark energy consisted of 8 Higgs force energies associated with 8 permanent matter particles, the up quark, the down quark, the electron, electron neutrino, muon neutrino, tau neutrino, the xeno, and photino, and they represented 69% of our universe's energy mass. Furthermore, from 100 seconds after the Big Bang to the present time, those percentages remain constant. In other words, there was no quintessence in our universe. At the time, 5.4 times 10 to the exponent minus 44 seconds, or the Planck time, four forces in our universe were united. At that particular time, the gravitational force in the form of gravitons condensed out from the singularity along with its superpartner, the gravitino, and their two supersymmetric Higgs particles. At a time 10 to the exponent minus 36 seconds, or the grand unification time, three forces in our universe were united. At that particular time, the strong force in the form of gluons condensed out from the singularity along with the superpartner, the gluino, and their two supersymmetric Higgs particles. And at 10 to the exponent minus 12 seconds, two forces were united. At that particular time, the electromagnetic force condensed out in the form of photons along with the superpartner, the photinos. In addition, the weak force in the form of WZs condensed out along with its superpartner, the weak xenos, and their four supersymmetric Higgs particles. At a time less than 10 to the minus 36 seconds, 12 superpartner forces and their 12 Higgsinos condensed out from the superforce. Those particles were X bosons or inflatons. It was the energy from those particles which expanded the universe during the inflationary period, just as dark energy expanded our universe from the end of inflation to the present time. This figure shows the radius of the observed universe versus the time after the Big Bang. This figure was taken from Alan Guth's book, The Inflationary Universe, with the following key amplification. I started inflation when the size of the universe was a sphere inside a Planck cube, or when the radius of the universe was less than 0.8 times 10 to the exponent minus 35 meters. When I went to calculate the exponential inflation rate, or the distance between here and here, I came out with the number 10 to the exponent 36. Alan Guth, in his book, started inflation when the size of the observable universe was much smaller. When he went to calculate his inflation rate, he came out with the number 10 to the 53. If you read Little and Lyle's book, they basically state that the exponential inflation rate had to be greater than 10 to the exponent 26. So my 10 to the 36 was greater than Little and Lyle's 10 to the 26, but it was less than Alan Guth's 10 to the 53rd. Now currently, BICEP-2 and Planck satellite measurements are being made trying to correlate mode B polarization with inflation. It is my hope that they make this correlation, and not only will they make the correlation, they will calculate the actual amount of exponential inflation rate. And at that time, we can select between three estimates, Little and Lyle's 10 to the 26th, my 10 to the 36th, or Alan Guth's 10 to the 53rd. Amplification of Higgs forces were key to the two-step theory of everything. The Higgs force was one order of magnitude more important than any of the 19 other theories. Superforces were God particles because they represented 100% of our universe's energy mass at time t equals zero. Higgs particles were associate God particles because they equal approximately 82% of all our universe's energy mass at the present time. The sum of eight Higgs force energies associated with eight permanent matter particles is dark energy, and that equals 69%. Dark matter, which is consists of the xenos, photino, and three permanent Higgsinos, represent 26%. If you assume half of dark matter are Higgsinos, that means that 69% plus 13% equal 82% of our universe is made up of either permanent Higgs forces or permanent Higgsinos. Matter particles and their associated Higgs forces were one and inseparable. The model I use is an undersized porcupine with overgrown spines. The undersized porcupine represents, for example, an up quark closed string in a Planck cube, and the overgrown spines are the three-dimensional Higgs force field which is permanently attached to that matter particle. No matter where the matter particle goes, its Higgs force goes with it. You cannot have a matter particle without its Higgs force, or vice versa. It was the extremely high temperatures in our early universe that caused spontaneous symmetry breaking, not the Higgs force. The Higgs force was a product, not the cause, of spontaneous symmetry breaking. Spontaneous symmetry breaking was very similar to the three H2O phases of condensation from steam to water to ice. Except in our early universe and at very high temperatures, it was the superforce that initially condensed to a down quark matter particle and its Higgs force, and then to an up quark matter particle and its Higgs force. Higgs forces were a residual superforce which contained the mass, charges, and spin of the matter particle. Mass was given to a matter particle via the Higgs force and the gravitational force messenger particle, as I will describe in a subsequent chart. Spontaneous symmetry breaking was bidirectional. The superforce could condense to a matter particle and its Higgs force, or a matter particle and its Higgs force could evaporate back to the superforce. And a good example of that is the beta decay equation, which basically states that a down quark decays to an up quark plus a W minus particle. Now that equation gives the correct results, but the process is completely misunderstood because a down quark is a fundamental matter particle, which means it's indivisible and it cannot be divided into two parts. The correct beta decay equation with amplification of Higgs forces reads as follows. The down quark matter particle and its Higgs force evaporate up to the superforce. Now you have energy that's easily subdivided into two parts. One part condenses to the up quark matter particle and its Higgs force, and the second to a W minus particle and its Higgs force. This bidirectional evaporation condensation process is key to both baryogenesis and quark storm matter evaporation to the associated black hole energy, as will be described in subsequent charts. This is the up quark baryogenesis and spontaneous symmetry breaking function. There are three axes. The z-axis represents energy density, more specifically its superforce energy density allocated to up quarks and the Higgs forces. The x-axis represents the Higgs force associated with a single up quark. The y-axis represents a single Higgs force associated with a single anti-up quark. Baryogenesis occurred as follows. The ball was initially at the peak position, and it came down midway between the x and y axis. What that meant was, initially, the superforce condensed in equal amounts to the up quark matter particle and its six force, and to an anti-up quark matter particle and its six force. A portion of the up quark matter particles and their Higgs forces was retained, but the remaining four particles annihilated and the ball returned to its peak position. On the second condensation evaporation cycle, the ball came down closer to the x-axis than to the y-axis. Once again, those four particles annihilated and the ball returned to the peak position. After n of these condensation evaporation cycles, the ball eventually came down to its position shown in the figure. And what that meant was that the superforce condensed entirely to up quark matter particles and their Higgs forces, and none to any up quark matter particles and their Higgs forces. This is the process of baryogenesis, which I will describe in subsequent charts. There were two key positions of the ball. When the ball was in the peak position, none of the superforce energy density had condensed to either up quark matter particles or their Higgs forces. When the ball was in the position shown, all of the superforce energy density had condensed to up quark matter particles and Higgs forces associated with up quark matter particles. The z-coordinate of the ball represented the superforce energy density condensed to Higgs forces associated with up quarks. And the z-coordinate of the peak position minus the z-coordinate of the ball position gave the superforce energy density, which condensed to up quark matter particles. It took a fraction of a second for the ball to go from its peak position to the position shown here. It took another 13.8 billion years for that ball to move vertically down to its present position, which is just over the vacuum circle for up quarks. In its 13.8 billion year descent, the x-coordinate of the ball remained constant, and that was the Higgs force associated with the up quark, whereas the z-coordinate of the ball, which was the Higgs force energy densities associated with the up quark, that slowly decreased as our universe expanded. There are two types of spontaneous symmetry breaking. Type one consists of those eight permanent standard model supersymmetric matter particles. There were nine transient matter particles in our universe: the top quark, the bottom quark, the charm quark, the strange quark, the muon, the tau, the gravitino, the gluino, and the WZ particles. There were eight permanent matter particles in our universe: the up quark, the down quark, the electron, electron neutrino, muon neutrino, tau neutrino, the zeno, and photino. By 100 seconds after the Big Bang, those nine transient matter particles and their Higgs forces had evaporated up to the superforce and condensed down to the eight permanent matter particles and the Higgs forces, a process known as decay. Each of the eight permanent matter particles had the same generic up quark Mexican hat shape that I showed you on the previous chart. However, each one had a different peak superforce energy density, that was the peak Z coordinate, and each had a different Higgs force, which was the ball X coordinate. The type II matter particles are the three permanent Higgsenotypes associated with the graviton, the gluon, and the photon. In the Higgseno version of the up quark baryogenesis and spontaneous symmetry breaking function, once again, the ball started at its peak position, and eventually it came down along the z-x-axis until it intersected the vacuum circle for Higgsenos associated with either the graviton, the gluon, or photon. What that meant was all the super energy density condensed to Higgsenos and none to the associated force particle, the graviton, gluon, and photon. The type 3 matter particles consisted of 12 supersymmetric xenos associated with 12 superpartner forces. They did not experience baryogenesis or spontaneous symmetry breaking because those particles were the X bosons or inflatons, and that energy was used to inflate our universe during the inflationary period. Decays are a series of evaporation condensation of matter particles and the Higgs forces to and from the superforce. The heaviest matter particles condense directly from the superforce, and a good example of that is the gravitino. The lighter matter particles were created primarily via decay of the heavier particles. The decays were gauge-mediated interactions where the heavier matter particle decayed to a lighter matter particle and intermediate forces. The intermediate force particles were WZs for standard model particles and WINOs for supersymmetric particles. For example, a W minus decayed to an electron and an anti-electron neutrino, whereas the WINOs decayed to standard model particles, either quarks or leptons. The superpartner decay chain ended with the lightest supersymmetric particle, or xenos and photinos, and the stable lightest supersymmetric particles included xenos, photinos, and three permanent Higgsino types. Neutrinos oscillated between three flavors using the seesaw model. The three flavors were the electron neutrino, muon neutrino, and tau neutrino. In the seesaw model, neutrino mass was m subscript d squared divided by m nhl, where md was the Dirac mass from the standard model, and m nhl was the neutral heavy lepton mass. The neutral heavy lepton was assumed to be the stable fourth family neutrino, either a xeno or a photino. Dark matter was the lightest supersymmetric particle, or a neutralino, or an amalgam of the xeno, photino, and three permanent Higgsinos. Dark matter agglomeration started at 30,000 years, and they formed the framework of all the galaxies in our universe. At 380,000 years after the Big Bang, the electrically neutral atoms formed, and they began clumping around those dark matter nodes. Dark energy was the sum of eight permanent Higgs force energies, and by 100 seconds after the Big Bang, there were just 22 permanent matter particles remaining. There were eight permanent matter particles and their Higgs forces, which were dark energy. There were three permanent Higgsino types and their three standard model forces. The cosmological constant lambda was proportional to dark energy density, or the cosmological constant equal a constant multiplied by dark energy density. Dark energy density, also known as vacuum energy density, was uniformly distributed in our universe. It was the sum of eight permanent Higgs force energy densities, and it decreased with time along with the cosmological constant as our universe expanded. In other words, the cosmological constant was not a constant. Baryonic matter could be changed only by Big Bang, stellar, and supernova nucleosynthesis. Nucleosynthesis changed total up and down quark rest mass without changing total baryonic energy mass. And the reason for that is only 1% of a proton neutron's energy mass was rest mass, the rest was nuclear binding, and nuclear binding was only a fraction of the total kinetic and potential energy. Furthermore, when rest mass was converted to energy and radiation, that was absorbed by the surrounding particles. There were four types of sequential universe expansions. The first occurred between time t equals zero and the beginning of inflation. This was driven by entropy increase of the superforce, the gravitons, the gravitinos, etc. And it was very similar to the loosening of a smaller than Planck cube sized sphere of vibrating strings. The second expansion phase was the inflationary period, and that was very similar to a water can freezing and bursting. More energy exists in liquid than frozen water, and when water freezes, latent heat is released. The latent heat were those 12 superpartner forces, their 12 associated Higgsinos, and the 24 antiparticles, also known as X bosons or inflatons. The third expansion phase occurred between the end of inflation, 10 to the exponent minus 33 seconds, to 30,000 years, and that was a uniform distribution of matter expansion. The fourth phase was from 30,000 years to the present time, and that was known as the non-uniform distribution of matter expansion. Dark energy drove both the uniform and non-uniform distribution of matter expansions. The product of the non-uniform distribution matter expansion rate and the graviton's intergalactic propagation time was string theory's seventh extra dimension. Messenger particles were amplified to contain embedded clocks and computers. Newton's gravitational force equation is force equals g times m1 times m2 divided by r squared, where m1 and m2 are two particle masses, for example, an up quark and a down quark. G is the gravitational constant, and r is the distance between the two particles. The graviton computer first extracts the mass of the first particle, m1, for example, an up quark, from the Higgs force associated with the up quark. The graviton clock is initiated when the graviton is transmitted, and when the graviton is received, the clock stops, measuring the reception time. At that time, the graviton computer extracts both the gravitational constant and mass m2 of the receiving particle, for example, the down quark. The graviton computer now has all the parameters required to calculate force. It has m1, it has m2, it has g, and it calculates the range by the formula, the velocity of light times delta t, or the propagation time between the transmitting particle and the receiving particle. That force is conveyed to the receiving particle, and now the receiving particle must react to this gravitational force from the transmitting particle. The relative strength of the gravitation and electromagnetic weak force was due to a propagation factor dilution 1 over r squared. The gravitational force was activated first, and it was diluted by this factor 10 to the minus 39th. By the time the electromagnetic weak force was activated, all the forces were united and the strengths were equal at the Planck time, 5.4 times 10 to the minus 44 seconds. The heaviest matter particle was assumed to be the gravitino. The gravitino energy was created at the Planck time, but it was only activated when the gravitino condensed out from the superforce, and that time was T sub G. Now, we know that the weak force and the electromagnetic force were activated the time 10 to the exponent minus 12 seconds. And if you go up on this line and over to the left, this gives the radius of the observed universe when the WZ force or the electromagnetic force were activated. Now, the difference in strength between those two forces were 10 to the 39th. However, that's a 1 over r squared, so it's 10 to the 19th. So this gives the radius of the observed universe when the gravitino was activated. And if you follow this line to the left and down, The gravitino energy mass was approximately 10 to the 25th degrees Kelvin, or 10 to the 21st electron volts. Now, supersymmetric particles were estimated by the snow mass study to be between 100 and 1500 giga electron volts. In the last running of the Large Hadron Collider, no supersymmetric particle was discovered. So the assumption I'm making is that supersymmetric particles are greater in energy mass than 1500, but they're less than 10 to the 21st electron volts. This shows the 128 matter force particle accountability by the end of matter creation at t equal 100 seconds. There were 18 transient particles. They consisted of the top quark, the bottom quark, the charm quark, the strange quark, the muon, tau, the gravitino, the gluino, and the WZs. Those nine transient matter particles and their Higgs forces evaporated up to the superforce and condensed down to eight permanent matter particles and their Higgs forces by t equal 100 seconds. So they represented 0% of our universe's energy mass. There were 24 particles that represented 0%. These were the X bosons or inflatons, and they basically expanded the universe during the inflation period, and therefore they were all consumed by t equal 100 seconds. There were 64 antiparticles that represented 0%. All antiparticles were eliminated either by baryogenesis or by inflation, which eliminated 12 antihigginos and their 12 associated superpartner forces. Now, if you add up these three numbers, 18, 24, and 64, you get 106. 106 of the 128 fundamental matter and force particles were transient matter particles, and therefore there were only 22 permanent matter and force particles which remained at t equal 100 seconds. The first were the three standard model force particles, the graviton, gluon, and photon. They constituted 0%. Now, in-transit photons do contain radiation energy, but I assume they were zero by assuming that the energy was allocated to the transmitting source until it was received by the receiving sink. So there were just 19 matter particles that were permanent that had energy mass. There were six atomic, subatomic matter particles, the up quark, the down quark, the electron, electron neutrino, muon neutrino, tau neutrino, and they represented 5% of our universe's energy mass. The dark matter consisted of the xeno, the photino, and three permanent Higginos associated with the graviton, the gluon, the photon, and they represented 26% of our universe's energy mass. And the third category was dark energy, and those were the sum of eight Higgs force energies associated with eight permanent matter particles, the up quark, the down quark, the electron, electron neutrino, muon neutrino, tau neutrino, the xeno, and photino. The super universe consisted of nested parallel precursor universes, and precursor universes consisted of nested parallel universes. Our universe was nested in the much older and much larger our precursor universe, which was nested in the still older and still larger super universe. The super universe was modeled as a near infinitely large gumball machine, where one of the gumballs was our universe, and it had a radius of 46.5 billion light years. The parallel universes were the other gumballs, and they had a different radii than our universe. A subset of the gumball, which included our universe, our gumball, was our precursor universe. And the entire gumball machine was the super universe. Universal laws of physics and structure were assumed across the super universe. Our universe was homogeneous and isotropic on a large scale. If you took a cube which had a length of 490 million light years and you moved it anywhere in our universe, you would measure the same amount of atomic, subatomic matter and dark matter. Now, I amplified requirements for our universe. I said that dark energy was also uniformly distributed, which meant if you take this 490 million light year cube and you moved it anywhere in our universe, you would measure the same amount of atomic, subatomic matter, and dark energy, and the ratios would be 5%, 26%, and 69%. I assumed there was a center to our universe, and the center was at that donut physical singularity location. And I also assumed that there was a spherical boundary which had a radius of 46.5 billion light years. As in our universe, the super universe had the same 129 fundamental matter and force particle types. It had 8 permanent matter and 8 Higgs forces, which were dark energy, and it had a constant dark energy to total energy mass percentage of 69%. Stellar black hole theory was amplified to include both a quark star matter and a black hole energy because there was an inconsistency in the definition of a stellar black hole. On the one hand, they said the stellar black hole had a singularity, having either minimum area or volume. And on the other hand, they said that same stellar black hole had maximum entropy, which implied either maximum area or maximum volume. The quark star matter had mass, it had volume, it had near zero temperature in accordance with the black hole temperature formula, it had permanence, and it had maximum entropy. In contrast, its associated black hole energy had superforce energy. It had a donut-shaped physical singularity, which was minimum volume. It had near infinite temperature. It had transientness, and it had minimum entropy. 6 types of stellar black holes were defined. Supermassive quark stars matter and quark stars matter existed in universes. A supermassive quark star matter, which had a range from 10 to the 6th to 10 to the 10th solar masses, was at the center of each of our universe's 100 billion galaxies. Supermassive quark stars matter and their associated supermassive black hole energy existed in precursor universes. And when the former collapsed to the latter, it created universes. And there were supermassive quark stars matter and their associated supermassive black holes energy in the super universe. And when the former collapsed to the latter, it created precursor universes. In our precursor universe, a maximum entropy supermassive quark star matter instantaneously evaporated, deflated, and collapsed to a minimum entropy supermassive black hole energy, and that caused our universe's Big Bang or white hole. The Friedman, Lemaître, Robinson, and Walker metric is the accepted solution to Einstein's general relativity equation. The solution describes two opposing forces which shape universes. Gravity, matter, which basically attracts galaxies, and anti-gravity, dark energy, which repulses galaxies. There actually is a third force, the radiation force. However, that pressure ended at 380,000 years after the Big Bang, so just the first two were considered. Friedman came out with 3 scenario solutions. In the first scenario, matter and energy are in close balance. And in that scenario, from a physical singularity, the universe expanded at a decelerating rate until it reached an inflection point, and then it expanded at an accelerating rate. This is the model for our universe's scenario where our inflection point was 8 billion years after the Big Bang. This first scenario applies to most parallel universes because it is a balanced and stable scenario, and I've estimated there are 10 to the exponent, 120 parallel universes in the super universe. In the second scenario, matter overwhelms dark energy. In that scenario, from a physical singularity, the universe expands at a decelerating rate until it reaches a maximum radius, and then it collapses to another singularity. That is the so-called Big Crunch scenario, and the second scenario is the model for our precursor universe's supermassive quarks dark matter, which evaporated, deflated, and collapsed to a supermassive black hole energy. The second scenario applies only to a small percentage of parallel universes because of the second law of thermodynamics, which I will explain in some subsequent charts. The third scenario is where dark energy overwhelms matter. In that scenario, from a non-zero radius, our universe expands at an ever-increasing acceleration rate. This is the least understood of the three scenarios. The entropy of a black hole is currently defined by the formula entropy equals eta times A divided by LP squared, where eta is a constant. A is the event horizon area, which is proportional to radius squared of the stellar black hole, and LP is the Planck length. The proposed entropy formula for quark star matter is proportional to the quark star's volume, R cubed, and inversely proportional to the Planck cube's volume, LP cubed. Physicists intuitively believe that entropy should be proportional to R cubed. However, Bekenstein came out with this formula, which is proportional to R squared, and that's the accepted formula. The proposed entropy formula uses Boltzmann's equation. Entropy equals K log of omega, where K is Boltzmann's constant, and omega is the total number of different ways of arranging N matter particle close strings in the quark star matter. The quark star matter contains N matter particle Planck cube close strings and a total of M Planck cubes containing either matter particles or Higgs force close strings. N and M are very large, and N is much, much less than M. According to Dapokar, the total number of ways of distributing N matter particles each in a Planck cube as a closed string is omega equals, is proportional to R cube and inversely proportional to LP cube. This proposed formula avoids the holographic principle and its complications. In our universe, the entropy increases irreversibly with time and provides a thermodynamic arrow of time. Einstein's theory of general relativity is time symmetric and apparently contradicts the second law of thermodynamics. Schwarzschild's general relativity solution consists of a black hole, a white hole, symmetrical white hole, and an Einstein-Rosen bridge connecting the two, also known as a wormhole or donut-shaped singularity. In a subset volume of our universe, the entropy decreases without negating our universe's second law of thermodynamics. Our solar system was created 4.6 billion years ago. Entropy decreased because life was created. Life is synonymous with low entropy, high available energy, whereas death is synonymous with high entropy, low available energy. Our solar system is one of approximately 10 to the exponent 22 stars in our universe. And our solar system's entropy decrease did not negate our universe's entropy increase because of the remaining 10 to the exponent 22 stars. The ratio of low entropy to high entropy stars was estimated to be greater than 10 to the exponent minus 22. Similarly, in our precursor universe, there was a subset volume where the entropy decreased without negating the precursor universe's second law of thermodynamics. A maximum entropy supermassive quark star matter, maximum entropy instantaneously evaporated, deflated, and collapsed to a minimum entropy supermassive black hole energy. I calculated the dark energy reduction factor to be estimated 10 to the minus 22, and that was equivalent to the ratio of low entropy to high entropy stars at 10 to the minus 22nd in our universe. The dark energy reduction factor was the ratio of the supermassive quark star matter volume divided by the total precursor universe's volume. This shows a supermassive quark star matter collapse to a supermassive black hole energy. The supermassive quark star matter existed in our precursor universe up until approximately 1 second before our Big Bang. The supermassive black hole energy existed at T equals zero, and it consisted of this donut-shaped singularity of superforce particles at the center of a single Planck cube. Now, the supermassive quark star matter, first, it's shown in two dimensions, whereas black holes are three-dimensional, so you must imagine this circle being replaced by a sphere, and these Planck squares are replaced by Planck cubes. The second item is that these Planck cubes are near infinitely small. They're much, much smaller than the radius of the supermassive quark star matter, which I estimated at 50,000 light years, or approximately the radius of our Milky Way galaxy. There were two letters, M and H, in the supermassive quark star matter. M stood for one of 11 permanent matter particles, the up quark, down quark, electron, electron neutrino, muon neutrino, tau neutrino, the zeno, and photino. And there was one of three permanent Higgsino particles associated with the graviton, the gluon, and photon. The H represented Higgs force, and that was the Higgs force associated with one of the permanent matter particles that had Higgs forces. At approximately 1 second before our Big Bang, this supermassive quark star matter swallowed one additional matter particle, and that was the straw that broke the camel's back, because the maximum entropy supermassive quark star matter instantaneously evaporated, deflated, and collapsed to a supermassive black hole energy, and that was the start of our Big Bang, or our universe. This is the quark star black hole of Big Bang transition, and it gives in more detail what I described in the previous chart. The x-axis is Big Bang time plus time t equals zero minus time t equals zero. The y-axis is the number of superforce particles, and you will notice two hash marks on the figure, and between those two hash marks, the figure is symmetric in accordance with Einstein's general relativity, which has a black hole on one side, a symmetric white hole on the other side, and they're connected by an Einstein-Rosen bridge or a donut-shaped singularity. At time t equals zero, the number of superforce particles was a maximum because everything in our universe was in the form of superforce particles. Nothing happened until the start of matter creation, which I made time synchronous with inflation. During inflation, the heaviest matter particles, namely the gravitinos, condensed out from the superforce. During matter creation, the superforce condensed out into those 22 permanent matter and force particle types. Atomic, subatomic matter, or the up quark, the down quark, the electron, electron neutrino, muon neutrino, tau neutrino, dark matter was the xeno, photino, and three permanent Higgsinos associated with the graviton, gluon, and photon, and dark energy was the sum of eight Higgs forces associated with eight permanent matter particles, the up quark, the down quark, the electron, electron neutrino, muon neutrino, tau neutrino, the xeno, and photino. On the left side of the diagram, we have the supermassive quark star matter. That basically had a temperature, average temperature of 10 to the exponent minus 30 degrees Kelvin. It was a cold quark gluon plasma and had an estimated radius of 50,000 light years. At the start of matter evaporation, at the center of that supermassive quark star matter was a single electron neutrino and its Higgs force, and that was subjected to all the matter particles above it. That raised the temperature at the center of that supermassive quark star matter to 10 to the 10th degrees Kelvin. That was sufficient to evaporate that electron neutrino and its Higgs force to the superforce, which incrementally increased the temperature at the center of the supermassive quark star matter. And that started a chain reaction such that at the beginning of the first deflation phase, we had a supermassive quark star matter, average temperature of 10 to the exponent 30 degrees Kelvin, and within less than a billionth of a billionth of a billionth of a second, that was transformed from those characteristics to a hot quark gluon plasma with a radius of 8 meters and a temperature of 10 to the exponent 25 degrees Kelvin. And the conditions at this point were exactly equivalent to what they were at the end of inflation. During the second deflation phase, the remaining matter particles and the Higgs forces evaporate up to the superforce, such that by the end of matter evaporation, we had a donut-shaped singularity consisting of superimposed superforce particles. This shows the ultimate free lunch theory versus a two-step integrated theory of everything. In the first column, I have three laws of physics. In the second column, I have the ultimate free lunch theory, which is the prevailing cosmology theory. And in the third column, I have the two-step integrated theory of everything, which I'm proposing to replace the ultimate free lunch theory. The conservation of energy mass is violated at time t equals zero by the ultimate free lunch theory, because in that theory, before time t equals zero, there was nothing but random fluctuations or noise. And miraculously, at time t equals zero, from nothing, 10 to the exponent, 54 kilograms of energy was generated, and hence the name the ultimate free lunch. From nothing, our universe was created. In contrast, the two-step integrated theory of everything satisfies the conservation of energy mass, because in my theory, there was a supermassive quark star matter which evaporated, deflated, and collapsed to a supermassive black hole energy. In both cases, the energy mass of those two types of stellar black holes was 10 to the exponent 54 kilograms of energy, and that was transferred over to our universe. Einstein's theory of general relativity was also violated by the ultimate free lunch theory, because in the ultimate free lunch theory, there was nothing before time t equals zero. In contrast, a two-step integrated theory of everything satisfies Einstein's theory, because just as he predicted, there was a black hole on one side of the interface, there was a white hole on the other side of the interface, and they were connected by this Einstein-Rosen bridge, also known as the donut-shaped singularity. The second law of thermodynamics is satisfied by both theories. You may remember what I said in our precursor universe. There was a very small volume where that supermassive quark star matter evaporated, deflated, and collapsed to a minimum entropy supermassive black hole energy. But that volume was much, much smaller than the entire volume of our precursor universe, and therefore did not negate the second law of thermodynamics for our precursor universe. This is the cosmological constant problem overview. I will describe the overview on this chart, and the remaining charts will give details. Our universe was nested in a much older and larger precursor universe, which was nested in the much older and larger super universe. The nested universes provided a dark energy reduction factor, which was estimated 10 to the exponent minus 22. And that was the ratio of the supermassive quark star matter's volume divided by the entire volume of our precursor universe. In our precursor universe, at time t equal zero, matter and dark energy were uniformly distributed on a large scale. Matter and dark energy were not uniformly distributed on a small scale. And on the small scale, that supermassive quark star matter instantaneously evaporated, deflated, and collapsed to a supermassive black hole energy, and that created our universe. The cosmological constant problem was caused because the super universe's volume was 10 to the exponent 120 larger than the volume of our universe. Now, spherical volumes are proportional to the radii cube, and therefore, if we know what the ratio of the super universe is to our universe, the radius, that is 10 to the exponent 40. If we multiply that by the radius of our universe, which is 46.5 billion light years, it turns out to be that the radius of the super universe is 10 to the 50th light years. Now, I've assumed equal expansion rates. In other words, our universe's radius is to our universe's age, as the super universe's radius is to the super universe's age. And if you multiply those numbers to the super universe's age, is approximately 10 to the 50th years. The super universe was created by time sequential and concurrent cycles of big bangs through stellar black holes. I assumed four time sequential precursor universes between the super universe and our universe, and that dark energy reduction factor was a function of the number of sequential precursor universes. Hubble's law existed for precursor universes within the super universe, universes within our precursor universe, and galaxies within our universe. And Hubble's law was not a constant. The proof of super universes, parallel universes, is most viable by the NASA IPEC extragalactic database. This shows three nested universes at time t equals zero. Once again, the figure is shown in two dimensions, whereas these universes are three-dimensional spheres. Also, the scale of the figure is not to scale, because the super universe is 10 to the exponent, 120 times larger than our universe at the present time. At time t equals zero, I show our universe as the donut-shaped singularity, and I show a parallel universe of finite size. That meant that this parallel universe was created before time t equals zero. Both our universe and the parallel universe are nested within the much older and larger our precursor universe, and our precursor universe is nested in the much older and larger super universe. This shows the time sequential and concurrent cycles of big bangs through stellar black holes. Four times are shown on the figure. The first is minus 10 to the 50th years, and that was the start of the super universe's big bang. The second time was an arbitrarily selected time, minus 10 to the 25th year. The third time is t equals zero, the start of our Big Bang. And the third is 13.8 billion years, which is the current time. The super universe started with a donut-shaped singularity at the center of a single Planck cube at this particular time. And over this time interval, it evolved into the super universe. at this arbitrarily selected time, a super massive black hole, once again, a donut-shaped singularity at the center of a single Planck cube, that was the start of our precursor universe, and over this time interval, it evolved into our precursor universe. At time t equals zero, there was a super massive black hole, and over the next 13.8 billion years, it formed our universe with its galaxies. I show a parallel universe of finite size at time t equals zero. That meant that that universe was created before time t equals zero, and over the next 13.8 billion years, it evolved into that parallel universe. The super universe is explicitly shown at this time and at this time. Our precursor universe is explicitly shown at this time and at time t equals zero. Our precursor universe and the super universe are implicit at the current time. But you must remember at the present time that our universe and this parallel universe are nested within a much, much larger and older our precursor universe, which is nested in the much older and larger super universe. There were three sequential cycles of big bangs through stellar black holes. The beginning of the first cycle was the super universe's big bang, and at this particular time it formed a super massive quark star matter. That was the end of the first cycle. That super massive quark star matter instantaneously evaporated, deflated, and collapsed to a super massive black hole energy. That was the start of the second cycle. And at the time t equals zero, there was a super massive quark star matter. That was the end of the second cycle. That collapsed to a super massive black hole energy. That was the start of the third cycle. And if you go to any of the galaxies in our universe, you will find a supermassive quark star matter. That's the end of the third cycle. Now, concurrent cycles, there are two concurrent cycles of big bangs through stellar black holes. They're implicit on the figure, but I will explicitly describe them to you. If at this particular time we had a second supermassive black hole that was generated, over this time period, it would have generated a second precursor universe. And if at that time we had a supermassive black hole that would generate in that precursor universe, that would have generated a parallel universe. This is Hubble's law, and there are three examples of it. Precursor universes within the super universe, universes within our precursor universe, and galaxies within our universe. Now, in traditional Hubble law figures, everything is measured with respect to the Milky Way galaxy. And what is measured is recessional velocity versus distance. In other words, from the Milky Way galaxy, we're measuring the velocity of these galaxies and their distance from the Milky Way, and there's a relationship between that recessional velocity and distance. Now, I have two amplifications to the traditional Hubble law figure. The first amplification is, instead of measuring everything from our Milky Way galaxy, I will measure everything from the Big Bang location. What that means is, if I'm at the Big Bang location, I see these galaxies receding outward, and they are proportional to the distance, that velocity is proportional to the distance from the galaxy to the Big Bang location. The second modification is, instead of measuring distance, I will measure time. There's an intimate relationship between the distance that a galaxy has with respect to the Big Bang location and the time it took to get to that distance. Relationship is undefined, but it's a polynomial in T. It basically is D equals A plus BT plus CT squared plus DT cubed, etc. Now, the reason why I want to measure time instead of distance is I want Hubble's law to show me delta velocity versus delta time, which is acceleration. When I described Friedman's solutions to Einstein's equation, I said the first scenario was the key scenario, was the model for our universe, and it was the model for most of the universes in the super universe. The typical curve is an inverted S-curve, and I will describe that first scenario again to you. What I said was, in that first scenario, the universe started from a physical singularity and it expanded at a decelerating rate until it reached an inflection point. The decelerating rate is shown by the slope of the straight line segments. You can see that the slope decreases and actually becomes zero at the inflection point of 8 billion years. Then the universe expands at an accelerating rate, and that's shown by the increase in slopes of the line delta V divided by delta T. Now, the acceleration will stop at 16 billion years. I basically assume that this inverted S shape was symmetrical. In other words, the universe would expand at a decelerating rate for 8 billion years, and then it would expand at accelerating rate for 8 billion years. At 16 billion years after the Big Bang, the outer boundary of our universe will have merged with the inner boundary of the precursor universe, and the acceleration will then be a constant and equal to the acceleration of universes within our precursor universe and precursor universes within the super universe. Now, most universes obey this inverted S-shape curve. I show the inverted S-shape curve here and here. I gave an example of a parallel universe that was created before time t equals zero. If I were to plot that on this curve, it would start here, and you would have a similar inverted S-shape. Now, what the S-shaped curve means is that all the galaxies in our universe are accelerating out from their Big Bang location. They're accelerating out toward that 46.5 billion light-year radius or boundary. And that means that a parallel universe, and the analogy I use with that gumball machine, this is our universe, this is the parallel universe. If you look at the parallel universe and you look at the galaxies in that parallel universe, they're also expanding out from their Big Bang location. That means that our Milky Way galaxy is accelerating towards its boundary. The closest galaxy of the closest parallel universe is expanding out towards its boundary. That means that the two galaxies are accelerating towards each other, and that produces a blue shift. This shows four nested children precursor universes at t equals zero. Once again, the diagram is shown in two dimensions. You must imagine all of these universes are three-dimensional. Also, it's not to scale because the volume of the super universe is 10 to the exponent, 120th times the volume of our universe at the present time. The subscripts define the precursor universe. A single subscript defines a child precursor universe. Two subscripts define a grandchild precursor universe. Three subscripts is a great-grandchild precursor universe. And four subscripts is a great-great-grandchild precursor universe. In the super universe, there was one, two, 3, 4, 5, 6 children precursor universes. In the first child precursor universe, PU1, there was 1, 2, 3 great grandchildren precursor universes. In the first grandchild precursor universe, PU11, there were 3 great grandchildren precursor universes, PU111, 112, and 113. And in the first great-grandchild precursor universe, there were three great, great grandchildren precursor universes, 1111, 1112, and 1113. In the first great, great grandchild precursor universe, we see our universe as a singularity and the parallel universe of finite size. There are two ways of proving parallel universes. One is by an existing multi-wavelength technique, and the second is by an advanced gravitational observatory technique. The existing multi-wavelength technique is the NASA IPEC extragalactic database. And as I said before, the galaxies in our universe are accelerating out from their Big Bang location. The galaxies of most parallel universes are expanding out from their Big Bang location. Parallel universes are uniformly distributed between our universe's boundary and a spherical shell and the super universe's boundary. Once again, that gumball model. The undefined zero-point energy is a spherical shell, has a thickness estimated 2.2 billion light years between our universe's outer boundary and our precursor universe's inner boundary. Across the zero-point energy, spherical shell is the closest galaxy of the closest parallel universe to our universe. The Milky Way and the closest galaxy are accelerating towards each other, and that means that they produce a blue shift, and this blue shift may have already been measured by NASA, by NED. We want to go back and look at the data to see if they have indeed detected the blue shift of the closest galaxy of the closest parallel universe to our Milky Way galaxy. The second technique is a gravitational observatory technique, and that uses an estimated Big Bang gravitational energy waveform, which is shown on this diagram. Now, this diagram was derived from a previous figure that I showed you, which was the quark star to black hole, the Big Bang transition. As in that figure, the x-axis is Big Bang time plus time t equals zero minus time t equals zero. In this case, the y-axis is gravitational energy, and as in the previous diagram, there is a symmetry between this point and this point in accordance with Einstein's general relativity. At time t equals zero, the gravitational energy of our universe was zero because neither matter particles nor the gravitational force existed. At the beginning of inflation, which I made time synchronous with the matter creation, some of the superforce particles began condensing into the heaviest matter particle, the gravitino. I assumed that the gravitational energy of our universe was a maximum at the end of inflation because by that time we had created the heaviest matter particles and they were in the closest proximity to each other. They were in a sphere which had a radius of 8 meters. Following the end of inflation, the gravitational energy decreased as the particles became further apart from each other. Now, going over to the left side of the diagram, before the first deflation phase, we had a supermassive quark star matter, had an average temperature of 10 to the minus 30 degrees Kelvin, and an estimated radius of 50,000 light years. At the beginning of the first deflation phase, that's when we had that electron neutrino and its sixth force at the center of that supermassive quark star matter. Its temperature was raised to 10 to the exponent 10 degrees Kelvin. That was sufficient to evaporate the electron neutrino and its sixth force up to the superforce that incrementally increased the temperature at the center of the supermassive quark star matter, and that started a chain reaction. So we went from a cold quark gluon plasma, an average temperature of 10 to the exponent minus 30 degrees, and a radius of 50,000 light years at this point, And within less than a billionth of a billionth of a billionth of a second, that was transformed to a hot quark gluon plasma, a radius of 8 meters and a temperature of 10 to the exponent 25 degrees Kelvin. And those conditions were exactly equivalent to the conditions at the end of inflation. During the second deflation phase, which was the inverse of inflation, all the matter particles and their Higgs forces evaporate up to the superforce, such that by the end of the second deflation phase, we had nothing but superforce particles. Now, the period of this waveform is the time between this point and this point, and that's 2 times 10 to the minus 33. The fundamental frequency of this waveform is 1 over the period, and that equals 0.5 times 10 to the exponent 33 hertz, an extremely high frequency, much higher than the capability of either LIGO or LISA. However, if there's someone in the audience who can figure out how to measure this extremely high frequency waveform, that will basically validate the fact that there was a supermassive quarks or matter, which instantaneously evaporated to a supermassive black hole energy, and that will give credence to precursor universes and parallel universes in the super universe. In 1975, Hawkins correctly stated that Hawking radiation contained no information swallowed by a black hole. In 2004, he reversed this position, and he incorrectly stated Hawking radiation contained information. This is the black hole information paradox, and it's caused by misinterpretation of intrinsic and extrinsic information. The no-hair theorem states that a black hole energy has 3 information parameters: mass, charge, and spin. That's not applicable to the associated quark star matter. In contrast to a black hole energy, our universe contains near infinite information. Any universe objects, for example, an encyclopedia, its intrinsic information consists primarily of its relative orientation of up quarks, down quarks, and electrons. Intrinsic information defines an object's molecular, atomic, nuclear, and fundamental matter structure. In contrast, a universe object's, for example, encyclopedia, extrinsic information consists of words. And these can be English words, French words, or binary coded words. Quark star matter are dumb, and they can neither read nor store extrinsic information. Encyclopedia intrinsic information is lost in 4 star collapse stages. In a white dwarf star, the encyclopedia's molecules are decomposed to atoms, and the molecular information is forever lost. In a neutron star, the atoms decompose to protons, neutrons, and electrons, and the atomic structural information is forever lost. In a supermassive quark star matter, the protons and neutrons decompose to up and down quarks, and the nuclear information is forever lost. And in a supermassive black hole energy, the up and down quarks decompose or evaporate to superforce particles, and the fundamental structural information is lost. So Hawking's 1974 solution is the correct solution. Charge parity and time, CPT, caused baryogenesis. There are 3 CPT violation arguments that support themselves and the conclusions from my theory of everything article. The first argument is that the CPT theorem is invalid at the Planck scale, and that was made by T.D. Lee. What I stated in the presentation was a Planck cube defined a quantum of matter particle, force particle, and space, and that our universe originated as a superforce string donut singularity at the center of a single Planck cube, And quantum theory was invalid before inflation because our universe was smaller than the Planck cube quantum. The second argument was that in a highly curved space-time, they violated CPT. An example of that would be a black hole energy singularity. That argument was made by Nick Mavrommatis. He basically stated, in the CPT theorem, the laws of physics are unchanged by combined CPT operations, provided locality, unitarity, and Lorentz invariance are respected. He also stated that violations of unitarity were caused by incoming matter information disappearance. In a previous chart, I said that incoming matter information was lost in the collapse of a supermassive quark star matter to a supermassive black hole energy. The third argument was a quantum mechanics axiom stated the transformation from one state to another respected unitarity and entropy preservation. That was made by a Florian Hoepke. What I said was that a maximum entropy supermassive quark star matter instantaneously evaporated, deflated, and collapsed to a minimum entropy supermassive black hole energy, and basically entropy was reset to a minimum. The energy mass quantum in Planck cubes collapsed to a superforced singularity at the center of a single Planck cube, and during the collapse, quantum theory was invalid. In summary, CPT, unitarity, and entropy preservation was violated in the highly curved space-time of both our precursor universe's supermassive black hole energy and in its symmetric Big Bang white hole energy counterpart. And therefore, that provided sufficient CPT violations to produce our universe's baryon to photon ratio of 6.1 times 10 to the minus 10th. String theory, a two-step integrated theory of everything, and quantum gravity are identical because all three unify all known physical phenomena from the near infinitely small at the Planck cube scale to the near infinitely large at the super universe or at Einstein's general relativity scale. What I said under string theory was the Planck cube was the quantum of matter, force, and space, and the actions were described by quantum theory. I also said that each of 129 fundamental matter and force particles existed as closed strings in a Planck cube. And I also said that any object in the superuniverse could be defined by a volume of contiguous Planck cubes containing these 129 fundamental matter and force particles, and the figure I showed you was of the supermassive quark star matter. So string theory unified quantum theory of the near infinitely small Planck cubes, for example, those 129 fundamental matter and force particles, with Einstein's general relativity of the near infinitely large, and the example I gave was of that supermassive quark star matter. Two steps are required for the two-step integrated theory of everything. My fundamental physics step defined the amplified requirements and answered all the key physics questions. The subsequent two-part math step consists of the first part is an amplified E8, the algebra technique for particles and their interactions, and that was written about by Anthony Garrett Lisi. The two-step integrated theory of everything amplified requirements must be added to Lisi's current E8 Lie algebra technique. In other words, his technique is correct. He was using incorrect inputs. The correct inputs are there are 129 matter and force particle closed strings in Planck cubes. There are 64 supersymmetric Higgs particles. Spontaneous symmetry breaking was gauge mediated and caused by high temperatures. And the cosmological constant was proportional to dark energy density. The second part of the math step is an amplified n-body numerical simulation for cosmology that was written about by Vogelsberger. He basically has a large-scale lambda cold dark matter model called the illustrious simulation, but that must be amplified with the dark energy technique that I described in my presentation. So the two-step integrated theory of everything amplified requirements must be added to the illustrious simulation. And they include Higgs forces are created during matter creation, that atomic, subatomic matter, and dark energy are uniformly distributed on a large scale, that gravity matter and anti-gravity dark energy shape our universes, etc. Now, if we incorporate dark energy as I've described into the illustrious simulation, we should be able to predict the galaxy position and then validate them with the measured positions instead of what's happening now, which is the opposite. They are using measured galaxy position to predict the characteristics of dark energy, and that is backwards. The intellectually formidable two-step integrated theory of everything is a work in progress. Basically, the Lisi and Vogelsberger technique should provide the two-part math step with my integration supervision. This shows Table 5, the primary interrelationship between 20 amplified interrelated theories. When I started this analysis 10 years ago, I had five existing independent theories in the first column and the first row, and the table was blank because all the theories were independent of each other. After 10 years of analysis and 250 iterations of my theory of everything article, I was able to replace five independent existing theories in the first column and the first row with 20 independent with 20 interrelated amplified theories in the first column and first row, and I found all of these physical relationship between the theories. Now, the Higgs force is one order of magnitude more important than any of the other theories, so I will show you how the Higgs force interact or physically related to the other theories. The Higgs forces is related to particle creation, because particle creation is by definition the condensation of the superforce to a matter particle and its Higgs force. Higgs forces are related to inflation. I made the start of matter creation time synchronous with inflation. That meant during inflation, the superforce condensed to the heaviest matter particle, the gravitino, and its Higgs force. Higgs forces are related to spontaneous symmetry breaking. Spontaneous symmetry breaking is by definition the condensation of the superforce to a matter particle and its Higgs force. Higgs forces are related to superpartner and standard model decays. What I said was that the decays were nothing more than the evaporation condensation of a matter particle and its Higgs force to and from the superforce. The Higgs forces are related to dark matter. There are five dark matter particles. Two of them, the Zeno and Photino, were formed by the condensation of the superforce to the Zeno and its Higgs force, and the condensation of the superforce to the Photino and its Higgs force. Higgs forces were related to universe expansions. Basically, I said that the third and fourth universe expansions were the result of dark energy or the sum of eight Higgs force energies. Higgs forces is related to dark energy. Dark energy is the sum of eight Higgs forces associated with eight permanent matter particles. Higgs forces were related to messenger particles. I said when the force was calculated in Newton's gravitational equation. It required the Higgs forces of both the up and down quark and the graviton clock computer to calculate the force. Higgs forces were related to the arrow of time. What I said there was in our universe, entropy increases irreversibly giving a thermodynamic arrow of time. However, in those special cases, for example, in our precursor universe, where a supermassive quark star matter instantaneously evaporated, deflating, collapsed to a supermassive black hole energy, entropy was reset to a minimum. Higgs forces are related to baryogenesis. At the beginning of baryogenesis, the superforce condensed in equal amounts to a matter particle and its Higgs force and to the antimatter particle and its Higgs force. After n of these condensation evaporation cycles, the superforce condensed totally to a matter particle and its Higgs force and none to the antimatter particle and its Higgs force. And the Higgs forces are related to quantum gravity. I said quantum gravity, string theory, and a two-step integrated theory of everything were one and the same. I said that Higgs forces were closed strings in Planck cubes. I also said that the Higgs force was by far the most important of the 20 theories. Under miscellaneous, the general relativity quantum theory applicability. General relativity is applicable for all time between time t equals zero and the present time, 13.8 billion years. In contrast, quantum theory is applicable for all times except between time t equals zero and the beginning of inflation. At time t equals zero, our universe was a donut-shaped singularity at the center of a single Planck cube. At the start of inflation, 5 times 10 to the minus 36 seconds, our universe was a spherical singularity inside a Planck cube. Quantum theory is not applicable when our universe is smaller than the Planck cube quantum. General relativity versus Newton's law. I calculated 3 star factor products which defined our universe's volume, 10 to the minus 51, which contained stellar black holes. First, stars were concentrated matter surrounded by large volumes of space. Second, only a small fraction of stars were stellar black holes. And third, stellar black holes were compressed stars. Newton's law is applicable for most of our universe's volume, provided the expansion of space is included. In those subvolumes which contain stellar black holes, general relativity must be substituted for Newton's law. A mathematical singularity is different than a physical singularity. If you take Schwarzschild's radius and you plug it into Einstein's equation, you will get a mathematical singularity. In my judgment, these mathematical singularities have no physical significance. A supermassive black hole energy donut-shaped physical singularity existed at a Planck cube center, and that was the start of our universe. This contradicts Hawking's theory of no singularity at time t equals zero, and our universe had a quantum origin. The supermassive black hole energy had a physical singularity. Its associated quark star matter did not. The conservation law states that the energy, mass, charge, and spin of our universe's physical singularity was distributed and directly related to the energy, mass, charge, and spin of fundamental particles, atoms, stars, and galaxies in our universe. There is an indirect relationship between the energy, mass, charge, and spin of a particle in our universe with the energy, masses, charges, and spins of other particles in the first particle's immediate vicinity. That's the locality principle. If we convert rest mass to energy and radiation, that will be absorbed by the surrounding particles. Action at a distance with velocities greater than the speed of light violated Einstein's special theory of relativity. Converted rest mass energy cannot affect a particle at the opposite end of our universe. In conclusion, Hawking's single math step theory of everything should be replaced by my two-step integrated theory of everything. Because of its intellectual formidability, the two-step integrated theory of everything, or the integration of my fundamental physics step described in this presentation with the proposed E8, the algebra technique for particles, and the proposed n-body simulation for cosmology remains a work in progress. There were 6 two-step integrated theory of everything validation techniques. First, the Large Hadron Collider should detect all 64 Higgs particles. To do that, the two-step integrated theory of everything amplified Higgs particle requirements must be incorporated in LHC testing. The second technique was the detection of the hierarchy problem estimate of the gravitino energy 10 to the exponent 21st electron volts. The third technique was the two-step integrated theory of everything n-body numerical simulation. If the illustrious simulation is amplified by addition of my definition of dark energy, we should be able to calculate the galaxy position and validate them by actual galaxy measurements. The fourth technique was the background imaging of cosmic extragalactic polarization bicep 2 and the Planck B-mode inflation polarization measurements. If inflation is eventually measured, we should be able to select one of 3 estimates: Guth 10 to the 53rd, Colellus 10 to the 36th, or Little and Lyell's 10 to the 26th. The gravitational observatory detection of the estimated Big Bang gravitational energy waveform and extremely high energy, extremely high frequency 10 to the 33 hertz. And the sixth and most viable technique appears to be the NASA IPEC extragalactic database, where the existing data may contain blue shift data between our galaxy and the closest galaxy in the closest parallel universe. And finally, the most important is the seventh validation technique, and that is independent analyses and validation by physicists. Thank you.